post-Edward Snowden, has the conversation changed? Are more people aware now in the last year of not just NSA and the data that they're gathering, but all the data about them that exists?
Yeah, I think people are more aware. It still surprises me, though, how much people are not aware. So it's not just the NSA. All these companies, or even when you go to a shopping mall, they might be setting up these little Wi-Fi sniffers that sort of ping your phone to see who's walking by, right? The ubiquity of surveillance is really hard for people to grasp.
In the investigations you've done, there's tons of research being done about us and data right. being generated. What are the ways that our data is being used by companies in ways that we don't know about?
I mean, it ranges all the way from totally innocuous to really creepy. And one thing I like to point out is that, you know, something that seems really innocuous, like online ad tracking, you know, the ads follow you around from site to site, they're tailored to your interests. Even that can be disturbing in the wrong context. So one story I tell in my book is about a woman who was not out to her colleagues about her sexual orientation, but when they saw her looking at her computer screen and every single ad was for gay and lesbian cruises, you know, suddenly she was outed, right? So even the most innocuous of data gathering can have strange impacts that are hard to predict.
Do we as consumers have rights to look at the data that a commercial company might have on us and then dispute that if that's wrong?
No, we don't have that right. So we're one of the only Western nations that doesn't have a law that like allows us to see the data that commercial data gatherers have. So most countries don't let you see the information that intelligence agencies have, obviously. But commercial data gatherers in most countries, in Canada and Europe and the UK, you can go to them and say, show me the information. And if it's wrong, you can correct it or ask for a correction. And there's sort of a dispute process. But we don't have that here. So I tried to find where my data was. I identified 200 data brokers, and I was only able to see my files at 13 of them.
Of those 13, were they all accurate?
No, so that's the other thing, is the 13, there were probably about 5 or 6 that were very accurate. They were addresses of everywhere I'd ever lived. They had, even one of them had the number on my dorm room in college, which I had forgotten, and every phone number and my relatives and all sorts of things. They were very accurate. Then there was another category, though, of people who'd basically pegged me, because I live in Harlem, in Manhattan, as a low-income single mother with very low education levels, and that's not true.
And is this data being protected, or is private information about us being traded all around us?
Oh, our private information is being traded all around us. I mean, sadly, it's become a commodity. So the data brokers, for instance, buy and sell from each other all the time, and trade information. So if one of them has maybe your voting files, but the other one has maybe your hunting license, they might, you know, buy and trade that information. And similarly, the people who track you online on ads that follow you around from site to site, they also trade information about you on actual markets, like the New York Stock Exchange. They're actually instant millisecond level transactions. So when you arrive at a website, a little signal goes out to the auction. Oh, this person has arrived. Who wants to bid on him? There's like a bidding in milliseconds, and then you get the ad for the person who bid the most.
So what's our recourse? I mean, with credit reports, if we get a bad one, technically there's a way for us to challenge it or find the information.
Right.
But that's in a very specific silo.
Right.
You're talking about information, everything from our healthcare data to our shopping history.
Right. I mean, I don't know that I have the perfect solution, but I would say that credit reports are a good starting place, because the two things that we are given rights over with our credit reports is we get to see them and we get to dispute them. And that has been the baseline for the privacy laws in other countries that I was mentioning, that give people the right to see the data about them and dispute it. And if that data is being used to make a decision of any significance, I feel like the very minimum that I want is to see it and dispute it. And so that's what the FTC and Obama administration have both called for, actually, legislation which would allow that, which is basically, they call it the Privacy Bill of Rights. But there's been no action in Congress on that.
All right, Julie Angwin, thanks so much for your time.
Thank you.